The next item of business is topical questions, and at question number one I call Edward Mountain.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what its position is on whether bowel cancer screening is being carried out to detect cancer at the earliest possible stage, or whether it is being determined by NHS capacity for colonoscopies and treatment.
Minister Jenny Minto.
Thank you. Scotland is the only UK nation to fully adopt the UK National Screening Committee's recommendations to screen all individuals between the ages of 50 and 74. The UK National Screening Committee has not recommended a specific threshold at which individuals should be referred for colonoscopy. However, Scotland has the lowest referral threshold in the UK.
Edward Mountain.
And I thank the Minister for that answer. Professor Din at the Health Committee made it clear that she was seeing patients with bowel cancer who had been falsely reassured after sending off stool samples. Now, I accept that Scotland leads the way on sensitivity of screening for bowel cancer, but frankly, this isn't sufficient. The Minister has told me, Presiding Officer, that the reason why the test cannot be made more sensitive is that NHS Scotland don't have the capacity to carry out further investigations, primary colonoscopies. Can the Minister quantify the estimated additional number of colonoscopies and their cost by increasing the sensitivity of the test by 75% as called for by Bowel Cancer UK?
Minister.
I thank Edward Mountain for his question and note the comments that Professor Din made in her statement and evidence. Colonoscopy capacity within the NHS is continuously monitored, and the scope of lowering the FIT threshold will continue to be considered at the Bowel Programme Board. In the meantime, patients referred with an urgent suspicion of cancer via the Scottish Bowel Screening Programme will continue to be prioritised for scope-based diagnostic tests based on their level of clinical need.
Edward Mountain.
Well, you see, that just doesn't answer the question, Presiding Officer, because freedom of information requests on health boards that I've carried out across Scotland suggest that the cost for a colonoscopy is in the region of £800, or up to £2,500 if you were forced to go private. Does the Minister really believe that saving this small sum of money is sufficient excuse for not detecting bowel cancer as early as possible, making it treatable, and thus preventing people facing the potential horrors of bowel cancer, including chemotherapy, radiotherapy and surgery, which I know all about, or worse still, death?
Minister.
I thank Edward Mountain for his question and recognise the work that he has been doing to raise the awareness of the importance of having a bowel cancer test. From my own personal experience, having a father who was diagnosed with bowel cancer, I recognise the importance of carrying out the test. Mr Mountain and myself have had a number of conversations about this, and advice is that we should be working towards a lower threshold, but that threshold would subject more people to potentially unnecessary diagnostic tests while impacting waiting times for symptomatic patients. But I'm very content to continue our conversations to see if we can move things on.
Harper.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It is vital, Minister, that we detect cancer in its earliest possible stage to ensure the best chance of survival for patients, and our rapid diagnostic services, including the service established in Dumfries and Galloway, play a crucial role in doing so. So can the Minister provide an update on the Scottish Government's assessment of the impact of Scotland's rapid cancer diagnostic services to date?
Minister.
I thank Emma Harper for her question, and the work that the Scottish Government is doing has invested additional money to reduce waiting lists on colonoscopy treatments. We've also ensured that we, for another year, will have the mobile units available to be allocated around the country as necessary.
Carol Mockin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The latest Public Health Scotland data shows a shocking 21 percentage point gap in bowel cancer screening uptake between the most and least deprived areas. Does the Minister accept that health inequalities are a blight on Scotland, and does she accept this SNP government is not doing enough to close that divisive health inequality gap?
Minister.
I thank Carol Mochan for her question and absolutely recognise that there are inequalities in the uptake of bowel screening. And that is something that the Scottish Government has been investing to try and reduce these inequalities to ensure that more people from the diversity of Scotland do take part in the bowel cancer screening.
Question number two, Michelle Thompson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what assessment it has made of reports that Scottish universities' budgets have been impacted by £100 million due to a 20% drop in applications from international students in the last academic year as a result of new UK Government immigration rules.
Cabinet Secretary Jenny Gilruth.
International students play a crucial role socially, culturally and economically in Scotland, and it's important that we continue to do everything that we can to welcome them to live, study and to work in Scotland. Instead, UK immigration policies are attempting to turn them away, which is hurting our higher education sector and demonstrating once again that UK immigration policies simply do not address Scotland's distinct demographic and economic needs. The Scottish Government will continue to push the UK Government for migration policy that meets Scotland's needs and for these decisions to be made in Scotland for Scotland, to ensure that we can support our world-class universities.
Michelle Thompson.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that response, and I wonder if she agrees with the recent statement from Sir Anton Muscatelli of Glasgow University, and I quote, "By restricting student visas, the UK is endangering its world-class university sector. Time to stop the senseless self-harm to our economy and to focus on our national assets." To have a discriminatory visa system designed to satisfy the extreme prejudice of the anti-immigration lobby is an act of colossal self-harm. Surely, what we need is to encourage more undergraduate and graduate students by removing all visa impediments.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, Presiding Officer, I would completely agree with Sir Anton. Not only do international students enrich our culture and our cities, they support our universities through their contribution to our world-leading research and support this vital area of the economy more broadly. And Sir Anton leads one of our world-class universities, I should declare an interest as a graduate of Glasgow University. And in Glasgow, they can see every day the damage that is being done to our higher education sector by right-wing immigration policy at Westminster and indeed by a Brexit that Scotland did not vote for. The Scottish Government recently set out across our Building a New Scotland proposals a Scottish Connections visa, which would allow for graduates to work in Scotland to be eligible for Scottish citizenship. That is what independence can offer, while the status quo is continuing to damage our higher education sector. And it could not be clearer that leaving these decisions to be made by the UK Government, whether that be led by Labour or the Tories, is just not in Scotland's interests.
Michelle Thompson.
Not only have we witnessed a drop in international students coming to study here, but as the Cabinet Secretary correctly notes, Brexit has brutally removed opportunities for Scotland's universities to build international relationships. Does the Cabinet Secretary share my concern that Scotland's further and education sector is suffering under a refusal from Westminster from both Tory and Labour parties alike to acknowledge, own and address the damage of Brexit, and that the best way to address this damage is to return to membership of the European Union?
Cabinet Secretary.
I absolutely agree with Michelle Thompson's points. Brexit has caused incredible damage, not just to our further and higher education sector in Scotland, but also to our wider economy and society. It's the loss of staff moving freely, being able to share ideas, and of course of students experiencing new cultures. And the UK Government's decision not to participate or associate to Erasmus Plus is a particularly damaging example of this, robbing our young people of the opportunities which previous generations like my own took for granted. With both Labour and the Conservatives committed to this extreme form of Brexit, which Scotland rejected, this government will continue to make the case for for Scotland to rejoin the European Union as an independent country, which we'd see our universities playing a full, positive and a constructive role with our neighbours in Europe and ensuring our world-class researchers remain at the forefront of international collaboration.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Professor Conlon of London Economics told the Education Committee last week that higher education institutions here are underfunded. They have 27% less funding than institutions in England. In a submission received today, RGU say the underfunding of Scottish HE means a conscious Scottish Government policy where fee income from international students is expected to cross-subsidise universities' activities. Conlon later said, ultimately an institution is going to fall over. If you are happy to let an institution collapse, then it, funding, is sustainable. But it might not be ideal. Is the Cabinet Secretary happy to let an institution collapse due to Scottish Government policy?
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank the member for his question. Of course, he will recognise that as a result of a funding cut to this government's budget from his party in Westminster, this government has faced one of the most challenging financial situations since devolution. But despite that challenging fiscal position, the 24-25 budget allocates nearly £2 billion to both colleges and universities, supporting their delivery of high-quality education, training and research. We're also investing £1 billion every year in Scotland's university sector since 2012-2013. And this year, we have additionally protected an increase in cash terms to the research budget of 4.75%, something which I note was welcomed by University Scotland in their briefing to the Education Committee.
Pam Duncan-Glancy.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I heard the Cabinet Secretary, but the Cabinet Secretary will also be aware that Scottish Government funding to universities has fallen by £2,325 per student between 2014-15 and 2021-22. At the weekend, Sir Paul Bryce said, and I quote, "Over the last decade, government has just not been able to meet its part of the deal." University Scotland said, as a result, institutions face closures. The NUS and UCU say there's concern over retention of poorer students and university job losses are looming. So with that in mind, can I ask the Cabinet Secretary, does she believe that the Scottish Government is properly funding universities? And if she does, what does she say to those, including Sir Paul Bryce, who say otherwise?
Cabinet Secretary.
I thank the member for her question and for her interest in this matter. And of course, the Labour Party seem to have been adhering to the Conservative spending in relation to public services, including funding for our universities. So if the member would like additionality to our university sector, then I'm sure she'll be having a word with her bosses in London around about the allocation of funding to the university sector and Labour's proposals. I am content very much with the funding that this government is providing to the university sector in the context of a funding cut from the UK government. If her party would seek to reverse that funding cut, I'm sure we could have a conversation about the sustainability of Scotland's university sector. But until the Labour Party can take that decision, and I have not yet heard it, then I don't think we're going to be having an honest conversation about sustainability. But more broadly to the member's point about funding to our universities, one of the really important things that my party believes in is, of course, the policy of free tuition. That's not a policy, I think, that Pam Duncan-Glancy's party now supports. It would be helpful to hear from Scottish Labour whether or not, well, I see the member nodding, of course, people like me had to pay the graduate endowment the last time the Labour Party were in power in the Scottish Parliament. So we well remember the impact their decisions around about tuition fees had on those from low-income families. And it's this government that's helping students in Scotland just now to avoid accruing debt of up to £27,750 each. I think the Labour Party should think again about their policy on free tuition.
Thank you. That concludes topical questions. I'll have a momentary pause to allow front benches to organise.